Well, just before I do the reading, please bear with me that I won't be standing this morning, hence the rearrangement of furniture and quite a lot of back pain at the moment, and hopefully be able to get through that. But you just have to bear with the unusual arrangement and the fact that I can't see the people furthest away. I used to always be glad that I could see people furthest away, but there we are. Well, we're going to read now. I shall read a few verses from the first epistle of Peter, chapter 1, and verses 3 to 5. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Well, we're going to turn now to our first hymn, which is 265 in New Christian Hymns. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hearts to heaven and voices raise. Sing to God a hymn of gladness, sing to God a hymn of praise. And you can rise to your feet as soon as the hymn begins, as soon as the music begins. Wasn't quite the hymn that I anticipated in terms of the words, and I think that's why you got a little bit uncertain at one point. But we'll turn now to God in prayer. We thank you, our gracious, eternal God, that we are here together today and able to remember in a particular way your eternal Son, the one who died and then rose again from the grave for our salvation. We thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for all that has been accomplished in and through him for our salvation, that you, the eternal Father, in your love for us, sent your Son into this world, unworthy sinners as we are, and yet in your mercy, in your grace, in your loving kindness, you sent your Son into this world for our salvation, the one who lived amongst sinful people such as we are, the one who endured much contradiction of sinners, the one who faithfully proclaimed the gospel of salvation, the one who proclaimed himself as the way, the truth, and the life, and that in him alone is salvation. And we thank you, our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, that in your love for us you laid down your life, that you were willing to go to the cross, to the most shameful of deaths, to one of the cruelest of deaths, in order to redeem us, that you did not flinch, but that you went forward confidently, bravely, trusting in your God and Father, in order that you might pay the price for our sin. All we like sheep, we had gone astray and turned every one of us to our own way, and yet the Lord laid upon you the iniquity of us all. And we thank you, our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, that by your stripes we are healed. We thank you for all that our salvation means, for the certainty of it, that in your death and resurrection you conquered death, you conquered sin, and you conquered the grave for our sakes. And we thank you for that sure and certain salvation which is granted to every one of us who truly believes upon you, and that through your death and resurrection we have access into the presence of our God and Father, and that we're able to come knowing that we are accepted in the Beloved, knowing that our sins are pardoned, knowing that day by day our sins are pardoned as we acknowledge them and confess them and are cleansed afresh. And we pray now that as we come, Heavenly Father, into your presence through your Son, forgive us our many sins, our many failures, forgive us for the weaknesses of our natures, our human natures, and so easily we give way to sin, so easily we yield to the sins that readily beset us. Forgive us, cleanse us, strengthen us anew, we pray, and grant us day by day to know the cleansing of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. So be with us now and bless us in this time of worship together, and particularly in remembering the one who died and rose again. So we pray this now in and through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, we're now going to turn to our collection hymn, and in the New Christian Hymns, "Come ye saints, look here and wonder, see the place where Jesus lay. He has burst his bands asunder, he has borne our sins away. Joyful tidings, yes, the Lord is risen today." So we stand as soon as the music begins, number 269. Thank you. of the scriptures, and that's in the Gospel of Luke. At the end of Luke's Gospel, chapter 23, from verse 50, and then reading on into verse chapter 24, where we have the account of the resurrection of the Lord. So Luke chapter 23, and commencing in verse 50. Now behold, there was a man named Joseph, a council member and a good and just man. He had not consented to their decision and deed, that's to the decision and deed of a body called the Sanhedrin. So he had not consented to their decision and deed. He was from Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who himself was also waiting for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen, and laid it on a tomb that was hewn out of the rock, where no one had ever lain before. That day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew near. And the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then, as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.'" And they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Well, may God bless his word to our heart. And we turn back to that passage in chapter 24 just a little bit later on. So we're now going to sing our next hymn, which is hymn number 273, hymn number 273. Jesus lives, your terrors now can, O grave, no more appall us. Jesus lives, by this we know death itself cannot enthrall us. Hallelujah. So let's rise again as the music begins.
Thank you.
we turn again to the Lord in prayer. Shall we pray? We thank and praise you again, our Heavenly Father, for the truth that we have just been reflecting on, even in this particular hymn, that your eternal Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who died, he rose again, and now lives forever, the one who lives forever in your presence, who will return again to this world in great glory and to restore all things. We thank you for the sure and certain salvation, our Heavenly Father, that you've granted to us in and through your Son, and for the truth of your word and the truth of your promise that God so loved the world, that you gave your only begotten Son, that all who believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And we thank you for that. We thank you that the price for our sins has been fully paid for on the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you laid our sin upon him, and that by his stripes we are made whole. And we thank you for all that our salvation means, living as we do in a world of uncertainty, where there are so many troubles, and where none of us knows what will happen even in the next minute of time, that we're in a world that, humanly speaking, is full of uncertainty. And yet your salvation is sure and true. And for every one of us who truly believes in the Lord Jesus Christ and has found salvation in him, our future is assured. Our future is totally certain, because we know that whatever happens to us in this world, and that if accident and illness should overtake us, and that death might come perhaps in a moment when we don't expect it yet, as those who truly trust in the Lord Jesus, we know that we depart from our mortal bodies only to be forever with the Lord. We thank you for that, and for the peace that it gives to us in the midst of all of our uncertainties. And we pray for so many around us who have no knowledge of these things, so many who perhaps have known them but have turned away. And we think of a land where very few really understand what the purpose of this day is, who celebrate Easter with their parties and games and foods and gifts or whatever it may be. But in no way do they realise that this is the day when in particular we remember the eternal Son of God who died and rose again. And we are saddened so much by an increasingly secular, atheistic society around us, and the fact that there are so many who have no knowledge of the things of God and the fruits of our ungodliness, the ever-increasing chaos of our nation and the ever-increasing divisions. We pray, our Heavenly Father, that you would send forth your Holy Spirit in a new way. Turn the hearts of many people back to yourself. May there be a reviving of interest in the word of truth, in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. May there be a true revival as your church is renewed, and that many people might be drawn by your Holy Spirit under the sound of your word, those perhaps who at this present moment have not the slightest interest. Oh Lord God, put it into their hearts to want to know, and that there would be many who seek after your salvation through your Son. And we pray that wherever the gospel is being preached today, in many parts of this land, in many parts of this city, and in many parts of this world, bless the preaching of your word. Bless the gospel message. Use it to accomplish that for which you send it forth in the salvation of many people. And we pray that even today, the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ will make ongoing progress against the kingdom of Satan, and that the gospel will again and again be victorious over all, that many might come out of darkness into light, out of the kingdom of Satan into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ, that many might turn and give glory to your name through your Son. And we pray that where people don't really know and understand the gospel, and where they follow other religions and other faiths that are not true, which are not in accord with your word, that more and more people might realize that what the Lord Jesus Christ said is so relevant when he declared to us of himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. May there be many who realize that truth today, and that many might come to salvation. And for those of us who do believe that this day of reflecting on the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, that it might be a day of rejoicing and a day when our confidence is increased in all that is promised to us in your word, in that which lies ahead of us, particularly when we depart from these dying bodies of ours to be in your presence forevermore. And so we ask these prayers now in and through the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. We turn now to another great Easter hymn, number 276 in New Christian Hymns. Lo, in the grave he lay, Jesus my Saviour, waiting the coming day, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He rose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Again, we rise as soon as the music begins. This morning we are looking in particular at the beginning of Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, the first 11-12 verses, which constitutes the account in Luke of the resurrection. All of the four Gospels report on the resurrection. But what we have here is the most important event of all in the whole of human history. That people don't realize it. Jesus died, and then he rose again, came back to life on the third day. And you could say that, in a sense, that's the fulcrum of history. And the problem is we can't say exactly which year and exactly which month he died. No, we don't know that for certain. We have an overall idea. And the commonly held view is that he died on Friday, April the 3rd, in the year 33 AD. Well, that may not be exactly right. The dates we're not 100% certain about. But the facts of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, they're there, testified to in the four Gospels, and they are facts of history. Facts that every one of us who are true believers, we know them to be true, because, well, as we read in the Scriptures, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 6, It is God who has commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone into our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So by the Holy Spirit, eyes have been illuminated to know the truth of the scriptures and the truth of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we're now looking at that passage, particularly in Luke 24, and thinking about the fact of the resurrection of Jesus, and then what that means for us practically today, because it does have a very practical bearing on the life of every single one of us. And three main points that I want to deal with: the empty tomb, the risen Saviour, and the risen life. The empty tomb, the risen Saviour, and the risen life. So first of all, the empty tomb. Well, back in 1987, my family and I, we went to Israel for a holiday. It was in an early part of the year, the Jewish festival of Purim, which then went very quickly into the Easter period. But we stayed with Israeli friends in London, in Jerusalem rather, that we had got to know here in London, and met up with them regularly through the space of a year. Well, we stayed with them for a while. And then one day we visited a place called the Garden Tomb. Some here may have been to the Garden Tomb, and probably most have heard of it, in Jerusalem. It's a very beautiful garden, and there's a rock-hewn tomb of the sort that Jesus would have been buried with, a hole in the rocks, a carved-out tomb, and a stone that would have been rolled in front of it. But it was a very beautiful garden, and we sat there for quite a while, just looking towards the tomb there, the open tomb, and then we went and looked inside, and somehow it brought the whole issue of the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ to life. It became a bit more real. But then on that same day, we made a walk not very far to what's called the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, which is a very famous building. And long time it's claimed to be the very place where Jesus was crucified, and then nearby he was buried. And these two places, they're identified as what were supposed to be those places inside the church building, inside the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And yes, we looked at the place that was marked as where supposedly that was Golgotha, where Jesus was crucified. And then not very far away in the same church, a sort of tomb had been built, a canopy if you like, and inside there was a stone shelf which was said to be from the actual tomb where Jesus had been laid. Well, these are all claims that have been made from several centuries after the time of the life and death of Jesus. And the Garden Tomb, well, that was declared to be a possible site somewhere in the 20th century. It's called Gordon's Calvary. So we then went back to our host and hostess, Edna and Odette, her husband. And we started talking about these two places and, well, where was Jesus crucified? Where was he actually buried? So our friend Edna, she got hold of an encyclopedia. She took down an encyclopedia and she started looking up the historical background to these two sites which have been claimed to be where Jesus died and was buried. And then after a while, I said to Edna, I said, look, we can't be sure, can we, exactly where Jesus died and exactly where he was buried. But do you agree, I said to Edna, that he was died here in Jerusalem, he was buried here in Jerusalem about 2,000 years ago? And she said, yes, living in Jerusalem, hard to escape it. And then I said, well, do you agree that in this once very small city of Jerusalem, the body of Jesus was never ever found? And she agreed, yes, that's true. And I said, well, do you then agree that the Christian church was first established in this very city of Jerusalem after the death of Jesus, very soon after the death of Jesus, when his own disciples, they risked their lives by declaring publicly in this city that they'd seen him risen from the dead and his body was never found? And she agreed with me. Well, that's where our discussion ended, and we didn't actually come back to it. But you know, many people today, they dismiss the gospel accounts without even reading them. I mean, most people dismiss the Bible in total ignorance anyway, when they do dismiss it. And they try to tell us it's old myths, it's old legends, and well, you can't really trust the Bible. And that's the general outlook today. Many say it out of ignorance. Many say it out of very anti-Christian prejudice. They just don't want the Christian faith, and they don't want anybody else to have it as well. And so many, they follow the forever changing views of self-proclaimed experts and journalists who try to tell us what they think is the real truth. And then you get things like the Da Vinci Code, which has come and gone as a book, but other books like it around that time. But if they would just read the four Gospels with an unprejudiced mind and read them and soak them in, then they would see, to quote the title of an old book by translator J.B. Phillips, that the Gospels have the ring of truth. It's within the four Gospels themselves. If I can say it as well, many years ago, one of our elders, Merlinigo, for many years he was a missionary in Pakistan. And in a day when Christians were very happily accepted in Pakistan, and he said that the imams used to say to other Muslim people, don't read the New Testament, you're in danger of becoming a Christian. Well, it's the power of the Bible, the power of the New Testament. But it's this attitude that's so often abroad now, that, oh, well, we don't believe the Gospels. Lovely stories, but they're not true. Well, if Luke and the other three Gospel writers, Matthew, Mark and John, if they were just making up a story about the empty tomb and the risen Jesus, well, right at the outset, they made a very big blunder. And it's a blunder that they should never have made. Because right at the outset, they tell us that the first witnesses were women folk. Don't get too upset yet, ladies, because I'll explain that. But this is the point. In each of the four Gospels, it's quite clear that the first ones to see the empty tomb, and then the very first person to see the risen Jesus, well, they were all ladies. Well, in Jewish society at that time, ladies were not given any credit in terms of being witnesses and in court of law. And for example, the first century Jewish historian Josephus, he writes, and I quote, he says, "Let not the testimony of women be admitted on account of the inconstancy and presumption of their sex." Yeah, if you're shocked at that, you're quite right. Many ladies are much more reliable than many menfolk. I mean, that's the simple point. But that was the attitude of the ancient world. It was the general attitude, quite apart from the Jewish nation and the people of Israel. But then you see later on, in about 200 AD, the Mishnah, which is a very important book to Jewish people to this day. The rabbis teach, or rather they imply, that women were not qualified to be witnesses in court. Now, I'm not aware that Jewish people would ever think that today. Ladies are treated with great respect in general by all the Jewish people that I've known through the years. But it was that sort of attitude. And that's the context in which the four writers of the Gospels, they were writing into. Women are not to be trusted. And so what do the Gospel writers do? They show that the first witnesses were ladies. They were women. And that very fact shows us that, certainly beginning at that point, they're making a credible testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, because they're quoting the most unlikely witnesses. Now, many years ago, there was a man called Frank Morrison, a scholar, a writer, and he set out to write a book to disprove the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. So he embarked on a very careful study of the four gospel accounts of the resurrection, and then he looked at the Apostle Paul in the book of Acts, and talking about Paul testifying as to how he came to believe in the risen Jesus, and he looked at the history surrounding that time and those events. And instead of writing a book to disprove the resurrection, he wrote a book to prove it historically. Who moved the stone? Very famous book when some of us were young people, which is a little while back. And he goes through it very lucidly. And then I could add to that that many years ago, I think back in the 1980s, there was a special meeting at the Friends Meeting House near Euston Station. And the man who had been invited to speak, he was an Orthodox Jewish rabbi from Germany by the name of Pinchas Lapid. And the subject was the resurrection of Jesus. He'd written a book on that subject, which I'd read by that time. So I went with great interest to hear this man in the Friends Meeting House. And I always remember one statement that he made, particularly. He said, when you think of the disciples of Jesus and how they were hiding away in fear, and then 3 days later, they were emboldened, they were brave, they were out proclaiming that Jesus had risen from the grave, and they were completely different. He said, really, there's only one thing that can account for that difference, that the Jesus who had been crucified had risen from the grave. I still remember him saying that. It really stuck in my mind. I mean, his book on that subject is just a little bit more ambiguous, but he declared it so plainly that I've never forgotten it. Well, what am I saying? If we look at the facts, the resurrection, it is a fact of history. There are no two ways about it. And people don't believe it because they don't read about it and they don't think it. But if we face up to the reality of the gospel testimony, and to these, if you like, co-testimonies to the reality of the death and resurrection of Jesus, the reality of the empty tomb, because nobody can deny that, then you're compelled to acknowledge the gospel, if you're honest, and to believe that Jesus is the crucified and risen Saviour and the one in whom alone is salvation. Well, that's my first main point. Well, going now on to my second main point, the risen Saviour. Why did Jesus die and then rise again? What was the purpose, the meaning of it? Well, Jesus died and rose again to defeat Satan on our behalf. And that's what we see in the very first gospel promise. It's in the book of Genesis, chapter 3, verse 15, when God said to Satan, after the fall of man, the fall of Adam and Eve, God said, I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall crush your head, and you shall crush his heel. Yes, Satan it was who persuaded men to put Jesus on the cross, and hoping that they would crush him forever, that he was gone forever. And yet, on this very cross, Jesus, who was crushed by Satan, well, he crushed Satan's head. He scored a decisive victory over Satan. Yes, Satan is still active and busy, but the decisive victory over Satan was accomplished when Jesus died on the cross. And that victory is going on as more and more people are saved. And one day, Satan will be banished forever because Jesus died on the cross to defeat Satan for us. A defeated foe, and one day a completely banished foe. As the great 18th century Welsh hymn writer William Williams put it, faith sees the place and sees the tree where heaven's prince instead of me was nailed to bear my shame. Bruised was the dragon by the sun, though two had wounds, there conquered one, and Jesus was his name. Well, Jesus died and rose again to deliver us out of the kingdom of Satan. Colossians chapter 1 verse 13 says this, it has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son, of his Son, the Son of his love. So he died to deliver us out of Satan's kingdom. Yes, if we're believers, Satan can still lead us astray. He has many wily deceits and tricks by which he can lead us into sin and drag us down into sin, sometimes unwittingly, and sometimes we know what we're doing. But we're no longer under his iron grip. He can't conquer us completely. And if we really belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, well, he restores us. He lifts us up again. He restores us by his grace, because he has delivered us through the death of the Lord Jesus Christ out of the kingdom of Satan. And then the Lord Jesus Christ, well, he died and he rose again for our forgiveness and salvation. It all follows on. Colossians 1 verse 14, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin. And then 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 18, Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that's you and me. He suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, in order that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. But then again, Jesus died and rose again to defeat death for you and for me. Commentator David Gooding, he says of those in Jerusalem at that time who condemned Jesus to death, I quote, one and all came to feel, for their various reasons, that they would be better and more secure with Jesus out of their world. So they opened the door of death, pushed him out through it, and slammed the door itself. But God raised him up. He did not so much bring him back through the door. In the case of Jesus, he abolished the door. And that's for you and for me. If we believe in him, the door of death is abolished. Yes, physically, we will die. And probably many of us are much nearer than many of you in the congregation to that point where we will be gone, that death will take us. But this is the wonderful truth. Because Jesus died and rose again, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, 55, O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Yet death is not a welcome prospect, but the sting of death is gone for every one of us who believes, because Jesus died and then rose again. Well, in addition, the Lord Jesus Christ, he died and rose again to restore the whole of this physical creation, this earth, and the whole of the cosmos beyond. Because if you read in the book of Romans, for example, chapter 8, verse 21, it tells us that the entire physical creation has been subjected to futility because of our sin. That the entire physical creation, it is deteriorating, it's winding down, it's burning out. You can put it in many different ways. And yet, for example, in Colossians 1, verses 19 to 21, we're told that one day the whole of this physical creation, the whole cosmos, will be finally delivered from this curse of sin that's upon it because of our sin, delivered because Jesus died to restore all things, as Scripture says. I quote from Colossians 1, verses 19 to 21. It pleased the Father that in him all the fullness should dwell, and by him to reconcile all things to himself. Not just people, but everything that's under the curse. By him to reconcile all things to himself, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross. You see how they're linked together? New creation. Jesus died to deliver us from sin and all of the consequences of sin, which includes the curse that's on this decaying earth, this ever-troubled earth, and this whole cosmos. He died so that one day it would all be restored. When he comes again in glory, at what time, we don't know. He knows when he'll return. Now think about it in practical sense. Our world, this whole universe, it's getting older, isn't it? And we're getting older with it, though we age rather more quickly. But it's all gradually running down. The whole universe is gradually running down. Stars burn out, explode. And it's an aging process that goes on, and it will go on long after you and I have been laid in the grave, unless the Lord returns. But it's a long-term aging process, and well, if we take the view that it's simply going to go on to the end, well, what do we have as a prospect? What does the human race have as a prospect? The astronomers will tell us that one day the whole of this universe will end in a big freeze. There'll be nobody to remember you and me. All our human accomplishments, gone, forgotten. All of the music that I so much love, gone forever. All of the arts, the science, the wonderful accomplishments, the engineering, the technicians, you know, everything that we've accomplished, gone, forgotten. Nobody there to remember us in any way. And well, even when we go after our short lives, it's not long before we are completely forgotten. Maybe our memories carried on within our families, but that's it. And everything, well, then in the end, we're just a mere blip in the ongoing time from eternity to eternity. Here today, gone tomorrow, and we don't matter. That's what it means. Unless we realise in this frightening, depressing scenario that no, Jesus died and Jesus rose again, the most important truth in the whole universe, to redeem us from our sin, to redeem us from death, and to restore this whole cosmos, this whole world and universe. It will all be restored in a new creation because Jesus died and rose again. You see why we say in every sense it's the most important event in history. And it is. Our whole salvation depends on it. And the salvation of the whole universe, the restoration of all things to what God intended them to be, all restored because Jesus died and rose again. Yes, it is depressing. And we look around at this world, and the more we look at this world as it is, the more depressed we can get. I mean, where are we going? What's happening? And it is. It's very perplexing at this present time. But no, instead of looking all the time at this world, the sins of this world, the tragedies of this world, the threats of this world, to lift the eye of faith to that which is to come. And to lift the eye of faith with Peter in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 13, where he says that we, according to promise, look for a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. That's where our focus should be. Then my third main point, the risen life. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now the fact is that by nature, we were all dead in our trespasses and sins, spiritually dead. No real desire for God in the proper sense. And sin came first, and all of our earthly feelings, desires, ambitions, we were dead in our trespasses and sins. But now, all of us who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, crucified and risen, all of us who trust in him for our salvation, we've been born again. We've been raised to life, spiritually speaking. We have a new life. We have a resurrection life, born again so that we can serve God, the Holy Spirit within us, enabling us to love God, enabling us to serve God out of love for him rather than out of fear and trembling, not trying to earn our salvation. We can never do that. But because the Holy Spirit is within us, because we've been raised to a new spiritual life by the Holy Spirit who now lives within us, then we're able in the true sense to live for God, still imperfect, but the Holy Spirit enabling us. Galatians 2 verse 20, it takes us a little bit further, where Paul says, I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives me. Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. He's in us. We live by faith in the Son of God, who are true believers. We draw our strength from Christ within us and his Holy Spirit within us. Day by day, we look to him for that strength that we need. When the temptation is there, by faith we look to him for the strength we need, knowing that he's in us, and by his Spirit he lives within us. He's the one, the risen Lord Jesus Christ, who now lives within us, enabling us to live the new life that God wants us to live, and to love and to serve him, and by his strength to overcome temptation to sin. And he lives within us, he's within us, to sustain us through our trials, to sustain us through our troubles, to give us strength to go through with these things. And when we're at our very lowest, no, he doesn't let go of us. He still is within us to uphold us, strengthen us, the risen Christ, by his Holy Spirit, living within us. So whatever we may face by way of temptations, whatever trials may come to us, this is the truth. Christ is in us. And we live our lives by faith in the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. Exactly as Paul says, the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. Just one last point about our risen life, given the inevitable reality of death. I said it on Friday, we'll all be put in the grave, one by one, unless the Lord comes first. Death is one of the most, well, it is the most inevitable reality of life. And it's a grim prospect. Death is not nice. Death is not natural. We know that. As your bodies begin to wear out, you realise you can't do what you used to do. I know that, only too well now. And there's something about death, it is not natural. It is the price that we pay because of our sin. And yes, it's a very grim prospect. But as believers, those of us who truly trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, well, death is not the end. We have a sure and certain hope. Because scripture says, if the spirit of him who raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in us, he who raised up Christ from the dead will also give life to our mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in us. So that's it. Yes, our body is laid in the grave. But if we truly trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, then that promise that by the Spirit, on when the Lord returns, we'll be raised from the graves and we'll have new bodies that can do and accomplish far more than we've ever accomplished in our bodies in this world, forever imperfect and forever decaying. But no, one day, raised from the grave to a new life, physically speaking, because the Holy Spirit is within us now, giving us spiritual life. But this is only for those who truly repent and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation, remembering that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. But for those of us who truly believe, well, our sure and certain hope, as expressed in one Christian song, is this: God sent his Son, they called him Jesus, he came to love, heal and forgive, he bled and died to buy my pardon, an empty grave is there to prove my Saviour lives, and because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Amen. Let's pray. We thank you, our gracious eternal God, for the one whom you sent into this world to die and who rose again. And we know that because he lives, we can face the future, whatever it may bring. And because he lives, and he is our Saviour, we know that we have an eternal salvation in a renewed heaven and a renewed earth. That even when these bodies die and we're laid in the grave, yet our spirit is present with you. That we depart from our bodies to be forever present with the Lord, but one day for our bodies to be raised again from the grave. And we thank you for this sure and certain hope. And may it be that everyone present here in this congregation, or perhaps listening online, might put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, turning away from sin by his grace and trusting him as the only one who can grant us salvation and will grant to each one of us a sure and certain salvation. We pray this now in and through his name. Amen. 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 We turn to our final hymn. A wonderful hymn to a wonderful tune composed by Handel, actually from his oratorio, Judas Maccabeus, which is about the Jewish uprising against their Greek enemies in the 2nd century BC and the overthrow of their enemies, their victory, and achieving independence for the Jewish people then under their own sovereignty for about 100 years. But this wonderful tune, which is very appropriate to the resurrection hymn that we're now going to sing, number 281, Thine be the glory, risen conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou, O death, has won. Angels in bright raiment rolled the stone away, kept the folded grave closed where thy body lay. Thine be the glory, risen conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou, O death, has won. We'll rise, stand to sing when the music begins.
Thank you.
And now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, for ever and ever. Amen.